All right, I'm going to play a number. Way back when I was first starting to play the mandolin, and my Uncle Penn Vannevar and people like that played the fiddle, and they played this old-timer called Soldier's Joy. So I'll play a little bit of it. Picked the mandolin. My brother Birch Monroe, he wanted to play the fiddle, and Charlie, he wanted to play the guitar, so there wasn't nothing left but just the mandolin for me. And so I started on the mandolin, and now I'm glad that that's the instrument that I taken back when I was real young. I like them old time fiddle numbers, you know. I learned them back years and years ago, the way they played them, and I think they played them the right way. Mm-hmm. So I try to play the note for note how they play.
Well, you keep the feeling, you keep the tones and thing, because you know there's a lot of stuff that you can put in there that don't fit.
And they got to be played to where you can dance to them.
Were there any other fiddlers around there beside Uncle Penn that they listened to?
There was no music in the country much.
Yeah.
There were a few fellas that could play guitar, you know, and that's about all they had to follow the fiddle with.
Yeah.
The mandolin hit hadn't got started good.
Yeah.
And they wasn't nobody playing the banjo hardly.
Yeah.
And the bass fiddle, it wasn't even heard of right there. Nobody played the bass.
How about Arnold Schultz? Did he play the fiddle any?
He could play the fiddle some,
yeah.
But he was a powerful guitar man.
Yeah.
He could play the blues, you know, the old Southern blues. Mm-hmm. And he was a fine fella too. That he played the blues, you know, our music was much faster, so his kind of music wouldn't work in bluegrass. So he had to put blues in a little bit different style and a little bit faster.
I was working with a group in Gainesville called Jubilee Hillbillies, and I was listening to the opera one night, and I heard Bill say that he's going to lose his fiddler, Howdy Forster, the late Howdy Forster. So I just get a handful of train and go to Nashville. Walked in the dressing room and I said, Bill, my name's Shelby Wise. I'm a fiddle player from Florida and I want that job. Bill said, well, can you play a hoe down? And I'll never forget it, I played Katie Hill for him. He looked at me, you know how the expression Bill got. He said, you know any of my stuff? I said, yeah, Bill. I said, one of my favorites is Footprints in the Snow. And I played the turnaround for Bill to do Footprints in the Snow. He sang it and I done my part. He looked at me and said, got your clothes with you? I said, no, Bill, up the hotel. He said, well, go get them. We're going to be leaving in 2 hours. When I went to work with Bill in 43, and at that time, he had Clyde Moody playing flat top guitar and singing with him. And String Bean was playing the five with us. And we had a gentleman by the name of Cousin Wilbur playing bass. And Howdy Forster's wife, Billy, was playing accordion and singing with us at the time. The first date was Rockingham, North Carolina. I'll never forget that, gentlemen. The tent had some holes in it, and it rained. I mean, the bottom fell out. And then people sit there with the shoes in their lap, just playing the feet in that mud. I bluffed my way into that job. I wasn't a bluegrass fiddler when I went to work with Bill. And many hours, Bill and I, just him with his mandolin and me with the fiddle, had spent in the hotels and motels to show me just what he wanted. He'd say, Chubby, on that footprints, he'd say, do a long bow like. And he said, Mickey, go.
Now she's up in heaven, she's with the angel band. I know I'm going to meet her in that promised land. But every time the snow falls, it brings up memories. What I found her when the snow lit on the ground. I traced a little footprint in the snow. I found a little footprint in the snow. I lived in a happy day, and it all threw away. For I found her when the snow lit on the ground.
And that's what Bill wanted, and that's how I progressed the style that I have right now, Bill Monroe told me. Like something crazy, I quit Bill for a couple of months and went to work with the Georgia Peach Pickers in California. When I came back, he had Lester and Earl with him. And I have never seen an audience take to a bluegrass group like they did at Earl. And Lester and Bill just tore them up every time they'd hit the stage. It was an encore after encore and a standing ovation.
Bill first heard me as on the Bristol station when he come through while Lester and Earl was still with him. And when Lester and Earl left, why, I joined the Foggy Mountain Boys, and Bill on his way through one time offered me a job. So when I left the Foggy Mountain Boys, I called Bill to see if that offer was still open. And in Easter time of 1949, when I was about 24 years old, I joined the Bluegrass Boys and worked about a year with Bill. Fortunately, I was with Bill and was on the last Columbia session with him before he went to Decca, which is now MCA. And while I was with him, he'd written Can't You Hear Me Calling and Traveling This Lonesome Road.
In the night you know, did you let me all alone? I worry so bad you done. I worry so since you've been gone.
While I was working in Knoxville with Don Gibson, along about 53, 4, something like that. And Monroe heard me playing with Gibson. And every day when we'd go out to work, go out to play, in other words, you'd look down the front row and you'd see Bill sitting there. And one day he came backstage and he told me, he said, now, Kenny, said, if you ever get dissatisfied with where you're working, just call me. Then he looked at me, he said, don't call me, just come on. That's what he said to me. This went on for 4 years, maybe. I think 57 was the first year I worked with Bill.
When I first joined the Bluegrass Boys, the man that's responsible for all the bluegrass festivals to begin with, Carlton Haney, lives about 30 miles from my home in North Carolina. And Bill Monroe was in our area for about 2 weeks doing road shows. And he needed a bass player. So Carlton came to my house and wanted me to do the do the bass for Bill Monroe for 2 weeks on the road there, doing little shows around my part of the country. So I went out and worked for 2 weeks with him playing bass, and he knew I was a fiddle player. So he would let me play one fiddle tune on his show every night. I recorded some of the things that everybody calls the vintage instrumentals that Bill Monroe did back in the 50s and early 60s, you know, and stuff like Roanoke and Cheyenne.
I heard Monroe doing this Roanoke, Cheyenne, and it was totally different fiddle stuff to me. It was kind of a challenge, maybe. I just wanted to see if I could do it. And after he'd already spoken to me about it, he'd never heard me play. I was playing mostly swing stuff back those days when he heard me play, but he liked what I was doing, evidently. And so anyway, when I heard those two numbers, I was making like a buku of money, but I know they had one little corner tavern over there. I'd go over there, and some days I'd put $2 in that jukebox just to watch this or listen to the Roanoke and Cheyenne. People just about run me out of there, playing the same numbers over and over, but I wanted to learn them.
We picked out an old-time fiddle number we'd like to do for all of our friends, entitled Little Roanoke.
First time I ever met Bill, I was 6 years old, and Bill came to Martha, Kentucky at a high school and did a concert. People started requesting and hollering out in between Bill's songs to let little Ricky Skaggs get up, Hobart and Dorothy's little boy Ricky, let him get up and sing. And so Bill put up with about 20 minutes of that, you know, and then finally he just said, well, where is this little Ricky Skaggs, you know? And so, I mean, most of the people there were like family or real, real close friends, so they started applauding and pushing me, you know, getting me up there and everything. So I come walking up in front of the stage. It's only like this tall. And so Bill looks down at me like that, you know, and reaches down and picks me, grabs me by the arm and sets me up on the stage and said, what do you play, boy? And I said, well, I play the mandolin. He said, oh, you do? And I said, well, yeah. And so he takes his mandolin off, runs it around the curl of the mandolin, the strap, runs it around a couple of times, and puts it on me. And so I'm standing here playing his mandolin, and I said, I sing too. And he said, oh, you do? And I said, yeah. And I said, I want to sing Ruby, which was an Osborne Brother hit at that time. And of course, the crowd went nuts because, you know, it was my family and my friends and everything like that. So Bill just kind of stood around, you know, and looked in the air like, you know, when's he going to get done and everything like that, you know. So as soon as I got finished, he comes and grabs the mandolin, takes it back off, unlooses the strap, puts it back on himself, and hits it about 3 times and says, now we're going to do the Mule Skinner Blues.
I always heard that when Elvis was starting out that he was trying to do Delta Blues and your music together.
Yeah. He come by at the Grand Ole Opry one time and he told me that he made himself acquainted with me. Mm-hmm. And he told me that he was sorry that he changed Blue Moon of Kentucky around, you know. I said, well, if it helped you get your start, that's all right to me. I'm for you 100%.
All right.
So he told me that it was mind you, one of his first numbers he recorded, you know, with Blue Moon of Kentucky. And our friendship was good.
As far as bluegrass's effect on rock and roll, it's always been a silent partner of that type of music. The first person to actually bring that forward was Elvis Presley when he did Blue Moon of Kentucky.
I said the moon of Kentucky keep on shining, shine on the one that's gonna let me.
April of 1952, Jimmy Martin and I came over here to this place, to Bean Blossom, Brown County Park, and at the time, Bill had one guy working with him named Charlie Klein, and Charlie was just kind of playing everything. And so Jimmy said, Bobby, my brother, was in service at the time, and Jimmy said, Bill, you don't have anybody working with you right now, so why don't I go back to work playing the guitar with you, and this kid here can play the banjo a little bit. Of course, I couldn't play that well, but Bill said, well, I guess that'll do it.
Now don't be crying on my shoulder and telling me the club's grand. And you know I can't be with you, or will you be loving another man? Will you be loving another man? Will you be loving another man?
Bill came through Dayton, asked my dad if I could go to work with him, and I was 15 at that time, and he said, yeah, take care of him. He was like, you know, another father to me, and he helped me a great deal in growing, you know, as a human being. He helped me a lot in that sense. Bill is very good at that, because he knows what people are supposed to do. He knows how they're supposed to be. He knows how a kid is supposed to be raised. We went to Nashville, Jimmy and I, that next week after that, and I still hadn't said a word to Bill. Nobody introduced me to him. I didn't know he was God to me, you know, and I was gonna go to work for God, and I didn't know him yet. And so we got to Nashville, and the first thing we did on the Grand Ole Opry, the hardest thing you could probably ever do for a banjo player would probably be to do Rawhide, Bill's old mandolin tune. And so I got down there 14 years old, standing on the stage of the Grand Ole Opry, and literally knees shaking, you know, I mean really, knees trembling and all this stuff. And Bill came out there, and he still hadn't spoken a word to me yet, not one word. He didn't shake hands. I was 14 years old and scared to death, and he said, here's a song that I wrote called Rawhide. And he went into it, and I thought, oh my God, I'll never get through this. First recording I ever did was with Bill too, and there's one thing we did, Pike County Breakdown, and Flat and Scruggs had recorded Pike County Breakdown at that particular time, and it was on every jukebox in the world. And I made the mistake of saying, I said in the studio that day, and I never had been in a studio in my life, and so he said, we're going to do Pike County Breakdown. And I'm thinking, God, how does he want me to play it? And I asked him, I said, you want me to play it? How you want me to play it? Like the other record or what? And he said, what other record? I said, oh, well, there's another record out. Somebody has done it. And, you know, I don't know whether you... And he said, just play it the way I played. I said, all right, I will. And I did. was in a little theater somewhere, maybe Grundy, Virginia, or something like that, in a little bitty theater. And we were kind of, had eaten between shows, and we hear this scraping sound, this whoop, 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 whoop sound like that. And we go back there, and Bill is working on his mandolin, on the finish of his mandolin with a little pen knife, kind of, you know. And I'm thinking, you know, I, kid, I don't know nothing, you know. I'm thinking, what's he doing, you know? This couldn't be doing for the sound. And he said, it won't be so pretty now. Maybe nobody will want to pick it up.
I made my first trip to Nashville in 1963, early in the year, at the request of Earl Scruggs to work on his banjo instruction book. And while I was there, he took me over to the Grand Ole Opry at the Ryman Auditorium. And everybody's jamming in the back room, tuning up and tuning down and putting their instruments away and so forth. And so I had a chance to pick up a banjo and play some. And while that was all going on, Kenny Baker came in.
I heard this banjo belting out this sailor's hornpipe, Devil's Dream, and several numbers, you know. Well, I believe he was in Acuff's dressing room at that time. Boy, I heard that, and I could not believe my ears. So I went to Monroe, and I told him, I said, you must come over here and listen to this boy. Well, Bill, he never went in the room, but he heard this banjo. He said, that's not my kind of music. So I said to him, I said, Bill, your kind of music, I believe that banjo would help you, or help us, I think's the way I put it. He said, well, go talk to the boy.
Later that evening, as I was leaving the building, Kenny came up and asked me if I'd like to have a job with Bill Monroe. Of course, I accepted. It was an honor to be asked, and Kenny and Bill both said that I had something new on the banjo that they'd like to have in the band.
Dale McCurry was a boy I'd met up in Baltimore, Maryland. I was still working with Gibson then, and I'd heard Dale playing some banjo. I didn't know he was a guitar player.
Dale McCurry and I started playing at the same time. About the same day we arrived in Nashville, and
he wanted to hire Bill on banjo, me on guitar and singing lead, and he never heard me play guitar, I know, before this. So, but he wanted to try us out, see how we could do. So he took us up in the National Life and Accident Building in Nashville there, and we rehearsed a little bit, and he kind of hired me on trial basis to see if I could handle a job.
When I left old Kentucky, Linda kissed me and she cried. I told her that I would not linger, I'd be back by and by. I'm going back to old Kentucky, there to see my Linda Lou. I'm going back to old Kentucky, where the sky.
Within the first week or 10 days, we'd been in the studio and made cuts of five or six instrumentals and a gospel tune. And these records came right out. There was The Devil's Dream and The Sailor's Hornpipe, Salt Creek, and a few others that Bill had out on record. And those were the only recording sessions we did. Left Nashville the day John Kennedy was assassinated. And I remember it was Earl Scruggs that told me, it was the first person to tell me that on the telephone. From Nashville, we drove to Miami, Florida. We played two shows there and then drove to New York City. Played one show there and then drove to Wheeling, West Virginia for one show. And our next show was in Los Angeles. So we kind of covered all three corners of the country in that the beginning. And less than a week, we were in all those places.
He was playing a show in Bean Blossom. And Bean Blossom, Indiana, is only, what, 4, 5, 6 hours away from Ann Arbor. So I drove down there with a carload of people, and Bill showed up without a guitar player. Well, he knew me just as the kid who'd been in charge of booking him at the University of Michigan 3 months ago. But I said, well, I know all your songs. And so I auditioned that very day, and on that spot, he was looking for somebody permanent, and I was much too raw and green to be permanent, but I did fill in on a big West Coast tour and stayed with him from April 30th until about, well, I guess it was toward the end of the summer. And that was my junior year of college. I went back home to finish my senior year of college, and Roland White became the full-time guitar player at that point.
Well, I believe I started in 63 playing with for my father, and I started out on the bass fiddle, and I played that for 5 years.
I guess it was 69, Roland and Vic Jordan left Bill Monroe to join Lester Flatt when he split up with Earl Scruggs, and that left a vacancy at the guitar spot again, which James Monroe immediately jumped into. And so that left a vacancy open at the bass spot, for which I volunteered and was hired, and did that from about the middle of March to maybe September, something like that. Those were my two stints.
I switched from there to guitar when Roland and Vic left to go with Lester Flatt's show. And then I started recording some with my father, and we cut, I think I cut some 90 sides with him. Two Father and Son albums, and some of the Uncle Penn stuff, and the Hall of Fame albums. I can't remember all of them, but did a lot of recording with him. We toured all through the country back in those days, in the 60s, and we worked Carnegie Hall and Newport Jazz Festival, Philadelphia Folk Festival, and did an England tour where we played the Albert Hall there. And that was great times. The money wasn't great back in those days. I think union scale was $25 a day for the sidemen.
We landed in the airport there in Tokyo. They had a banner. It was about maybe a couple of hundred feet long. Welcome Monroe and the Bluegrass Boys. And there was about maybe from 500 to 750, 800 people out there to welcome us in. That's, you know, that'll strike your mind once in a while.
Around 1980, you know, I was bad sick, had cancer. And this man from West Virginia called me. And he said, Mr. Monroe said, I know you're in a hospital and you're not a well man. But he said, I've got it set up, and I just wanted to tell you this. There's 24 churches in the state of West Virginia. All of them starts to pray for you at the same time. 24 churches, everybody in the church was praying at the same time. You couldn't beat that.
This was about 1982 in the midsummer. We had left Portland, Maine, going to Nova Scotia. We were crossing on the ferry, and Mr. Monroe was talking about he was not feeling real well. So when we pulled off in the bus on the Nova Scotia side, he said, I'm really having some severe pain, and I need to go see a doctor. So we rushed him to the hospital, and he was very ill. And they performed major surgery on him that morning. 3 hours later, he was on the stage with us, sitting in a wheelchair, playing his mandolin and singing tenor with us. And they immediately took him back to the hospital after the performance and kept him till the evening performance.
Monroe had gotten out of his hospital bed, talked the nurses into getting an ambulance. He was in a wheelchair. They took him to the festival that he was going to perform at. Picked him up out of the ambulance, put him on the stage, and he did a full 60-minute show in a tremendous amount of pain. And the audience had no idea except that they just thought he was in a wheelchair due to his age, and gave him a standing ovation. As soon as the show was over, he collapsed again, and we rushed him back to the airport.
10 days later, we had a festival in Waynesboro, Tennessee, and Mr. Monroe played all 3 days. We left there on a Sunday night and went to Missouri to do the state fair for 6 days, and he did not miss a performance. And his ability to snap back from the illnesses, it's something inside that says, I've got to go.
That's the real Bill Monroe when it comes to the show, I think he's always told me, I've been very concerned about his age, and he's always told me that his last day he wants to be on stage.
A lot of my music has Methodist and Baptist and Holiness singing in it. And the people, my audience can hear that. They can hear that there's different sounds, that the feeling of the music will go right from where I'm playing it, the mandolin, from me right to them.
Bill Monroe's mandolin has gone through several rather notably important changes in its lifetime. When Bill first bought it in a barber shop in Florida in about 1946, he paid $150 for it. It was in pretty nearly pristine original condition at the time. After a few years of use, it had a fair amount of wear, and Bill sent it back to Gibson to be refretted. At that time, Gibson not only refretted it, but to do him a favor, they decided to touch up the finish and really spiff it up as best as they could. Unfortunately for them, Bill was much less than pleased. As a result, he gouged the name Gibson out of the peg head, leaving a big gaping hole. He took a piece of glass and scraped the finish off the instrument, and he broke off this little scroll curlicue on the peg head. That's the way it was throughout most of the 50s and 60s and well into the period of the early and mid 70s. And it's the classic Monroe look for that mandolin. Bill's mandolin and others at his home were vandalized, and someone actually took a fireplace poker and literally smashed it to pieces. Gibson put it back together in what may well be one of the most remarkable restorations of any fretted instrument ever undertaken.
The biggest job, initial job of the repair when I received the mandolin, was to actually take the one garbage sack and with a microscope and tweezers and a piece of white poster board catalog out the different pieces for the two mandolins. At that point, it was given to me to take the splinters, some of them smaller than the size of this toothpick, and brush a special epoxy glue and regular sewing thread to hold the pieces together. And as those pieces grew, you could then take those pieces and clamp them in. On his famous mandolin, the July mandolin, it was in about 200 to 300 pieces total. They did such a good job cleaning the carpet and picking up the pieces that I only had to replace two actual pieces of wood in that mandolin, both of them no bigger than the diamond on a playing card.
They spent countless hours of time putting it back together so well that not only does it look virtually the same as it did before, but it actually has retained its original sound, so that Bill still uses this instrument today. In fact, I can think of no one musician who is more closely identified with one specific instrument than Bill is with his July of 1923 F5 mandolin.
His mandolin plays the two and the four, which the snare drum plays that in a rock band or a country band. He'll teach you how to use the guitar and to play the licks and stuff around his singing and to fill the holes and places. And so anybody that wants to learn how to play bluegrass music, Bill's records are, it's the training wheels. I mean, that's what you listen to, that to learn how to play. I mean, no other group can teach you any better how to play it than Bill does, because he lives and breathes it. If you cut his arm, that's what he's going to bleed. He's going to bleed bluegrass music.
I remember one time Bill was auditioning a fiddler, and he told him that in playing bluegrass, you have to have these hands working together, the left hand with the right hand, and you have to be thinking right in between them.
He gets a chord on the mandolin, he'll turn towards you, and he'll slap it a couple times, and you know exactly where you better be capoed to, or where you better have your instruments tuned to in that key. And you can usually tell by the story that he's telling on the stage or the line that he uses.
You stand up there and take your instrumental break or sing your play, your piece, and you are in competition with the guy that's going to come after you and the guy that came before you. Your job is to try to do better than the guy that just played. I've heard the old bluegrass musicians and the old members of the Bluegrass Boys talk of doing battle with Bill. Said, boy, you get up there and really give him a run for his money, and that's the way you get a good performance out of him.
So that I was sort of prepared for it.
But they were both buck dancing, you know. They
were doing really different things.
And then he took her like they were square dancing.